Thanks for joining us on Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Today, our guest is the internationally acclaimed tenor, Saimir Pirgu. We're happy to have you with us. Thanks for joining us.
Good to have you.
Happy to be here.
You started your career at a very young age. Something like, weren't you the youngest person ever to sing a major role at the Salzburg Festival? You were something like 21? Is that?
Yes.
Yes.
What
was the role?
No, I don't remember. I think if I will remember, I think how crazy I would.
That's what I wanted to ask. What was it like singing at a major house so young? Was it overwhelming or?
It's a dream. So you come from a country like Albania where you don't think that you'll be from. I left Albania in 2000. And in 2004, I was in Salzburg Festival. So like, I didn't have even the time to finish the conservatory because like, the career was going so fast. After I did the audition with Claudio Abbado and I did Così fan tutte with him, then I think Ramon Vargas was canceling. So I need to thank Ramon. He was canceling 6 months before. Uh-huh. So the opera director called, the casting director, Josef Husek, I think, he called Maestro Abbado and to ask if this young tenor that he saw in Ferrara can be okay for Salzburg's, like with Wiener Philharmonica first time. And at this time, Philip Jordan was a young conductor. He was 30, and the cast was Tamara Iveri, Elena Garancia, Olivieri, Thomas Allen, Ellen Donald. So like, it's a dream debut for someone who is just 21. So I did 22 on stage, I think, after a week. I was in Salzburg, so it's a huge dream for me.
How did that start?
You do an audition with a wonderful conductor, you know? And then you're from the school, you go to work with him and you have in front of you Ruggero Raimondi and Antonacci doing the role, no? And after 6 months, they say, you know what? You are good enough to go to Salzburg as well. And then you work with them and thanks God it went well.
Mm-hmm. How did you feel at that very moment when he said, okay, I'm gonna put you on?
Of course, like, but you, when you're so young, you don't think so much. Uh-huh. That's the good
fearless.
And the bad thing.
Fearless.
That you don't,
yeah, fearless.
You don't think, you just go. You just go and you try to do your best. And I'm just saying now that I see after how many years, like I see perhaps without my being violinist before and my musicality, I never would have been able to stay in those standards of music. I mean, Mozart, everybody say that it's the first, you need to sing Mozart, and especially the worst thing when the people say that sing Mozart first when you, it's like the worst thing you can do to a young singer, because Mozart is the most difficult. So the level of musicality for a musician, you can see it only if they play Mozart, Bach, and other stuff, the classic, real classic music, composer. So I need to discover that quite soon. And thanks God in Salzburg and in Vienna later when I was singing Don Giovanni and Così, and later with Nicolaus Arnoncourt Idomeneo. But I've learned a lot in this period of my life from Mozart, from Abbado, from the sound of this wonderful orchestra. But if you play with them, whatever you do, they help you to support you in the right way.
When you get on that stage, after you finish, do you sink again? And soon you know.
The thing is, like, I didn't realize where I was. I mean, from the school with Abbado, and then I did the debut in Vienna State Opera with Elisir, mm-hmm. and then right away to Salzburg Festival. So then later, after 2 years, I realized that, wait a second, now you're not anymore the youngest one. You need to learn, you need to study, you need to feel the technique, and careful, because these are two little muscles, and
so
you become cautious. I become cautious after 2 years, I think, when I saw that everybody was calling me just for Così fan tutte, and Don Giovanni. Because if you don't tell people that you can do something else, they will keep booking you only for those two things that you think are good. So then I have my protege Luciano Pavarotti telling me a lot of stuff. I've learned a lot of roles with him in.
Yeah, we heard about that. How did that come about?
that's for this I'm lucky. Oh. I'm the luckiest one in my. So I arrived in Bolzano in September 2000, and about January, February, I met Luciano Pavarotti in Merano, where he was going in those resorts just to have some nice time after his. And then he was asking if in Bolzano, in the little town in North Italy, is somebody there who can
teach you.
And it's like, and okay, we prepare a class with like 5-6 people. And my teacher was so proud that, I mean, we go and then, yeah, it happens like that. I sang in front of him.
What did he say?
I remember him like this, sitting in this with his friends Panocha and I was singing Una Furtiva Lacrima. And after two tones, when there's like Una Furtiva Lacrima, when Passaggio comes, he was like this and turned. And he stops, like, where did you learn that? Like, you're just 19. It's like, why did you learn what's Passaggio? It's like, I don't know what's Passaggio, but I know, it was like, how? Because I was listening Di Stefano, I was listening Pavarotti, I was listening Carreras, like, how I learned it like this. And then I thought everything is finished, done. This way I called my mom. And 2 days later, at this time they were not cell phone like today, right. iPhone and messages, WhatsApp. So he called where I was staying and it's like, I'm Luciano Pavarotti. It's like, yes, of course, Luciano Pavarotti called me. no, really. At this time, he didn't remember my name. He called me Ciccio Albanese. It's like, and then, no, it's me. I wait for you. If you come this afternoon in Merano, if you can come, we'll sing together. And then for like a week, I've been in this hotel and there where everybody was singing and going for Luciano Pavarotti and I was one of these people and I thought this finish is done. No, after a while he was telling me whatever you do, if you win a competition, if you do a audition, just tell me, just send me or call, I will answer if I'm there, if not. And we connected from the first time and till for 7 years that till we lost him. It's like I learned Rigoletto, Elisir, Traviata, any lyric role. It's a shame that at this time, at this age, I was not so able that I would have been now because it was too much information from the king of the tenors. Like,
yes.
But still, they're like little windows that you open when you need them.
What do you feel like the most important thing you learned from him?
Diction.
Diction?
Diction with the intonation.
Mm-hmm. Going hand in hand.
Connect them with the diction because like sometimes we throw sounds like because we need to cover, we need to do that, like too complicated. Actually, it's more easy to sing in a nice way and very normal, but we have lost that knowledge. I'm sorry to say that, and quite true. We have lost this knowledge of be free on stage. If we don't see people now screaming or throwing or being like you are doing a high note. So when you hear those tenors from the past, like you have the feeling they have everything under control. It's like Luciano was one of them. So like open the mouth and the sound was there and the intonation was there. Never high, never down, never low, no pitch, perfect. So, but of course you need to have that kind of gold voice to it helps a lot. And I'm not somebody who is not lucky with all this, but still it's a very, more you go in this art and more you discover it, more difficult become to stay in level and to discover high quality of music.
I'm sure, you know, your voice impresses him, that's why. And did anybody ever tell you that you might look like him when he was young
Really? I don't know that. Like, I've told a lot of people telling me that you are similar with Di Stefano. And even himself, when I win the competition in Milano Caruso, he was one of the judges. Like, it was him, Simonato, Luigi Alva. I have plenty of high-level singers at this time. And Di Stefano was coming to me in front of me and telling me, like, oh, nice, you sing very well, and I like you very much, and you are similar on me. I didn't recognize him. It's like, you know, Pippo Di Stefano, and then you see an old man, like, 75. It's like, but you sing like Pavarotti. It's like, you sing in this way, to cover, to open your mouth, sing, open. Later, you realize what the technique it is, what's now. And now it becomes more difficult because now people expect now a singer. It doesn't expect a young man who sing with a beautiful voice. So, like, it's difficult to resist in them. But still, I'm still here, still singing.
How long did you stay in touch with him?
With Luciano? Uh-huh. Till we lost him.
Oh, really?
Mm. Yeah.
Wow.
He was teaching, I mean, not to me, but in the last 3 or 4 years of his life, he have teach from his room in bed to this new academy he have done in Modena, I think. And a lot of young singers that we have now, they're from that generation. Mm-hmm. But I'm the one from before generations. Like, I have always see Juan Diego Flores there, Alanya, or because they all wanted to be in touch with him and connected with him. So yeah, I'm lucky.
You mentioned competition, the Caruso, and you also, there was Tito Schippo competition plus Pavarotti, Doro. What kind of effect did winning these competitions have on your career?
I mean, after you win the first one, you are happy, and then you say, okay. You win the second, and it's like, no, okay. You see, you become comfortable with the idea that you are someone. Then the third one or the fourth, and then going away, every singing in Vienna, London, Berlin, you realize that you have something special. But to keep this special is the most difficult word.
Why
so? It's work. Because it's difficult, our job. It's not that easy. It's not a job for everyone. I don't call job. It's a form of art who you give a lot and you take a lot, but has a price. It's not, and as much as beautiful it is, as much as it take a lot energy from you and then become more the hard, dark side of this job. We're like, and like I say, I'm a Balkan man. We're straight. We say things straight. We don't politically correct, doesn't exist in our, so we say that and the people get crazy. I'm just saying that it's like music is so beautiful. But it's like with all the color of arcobaleno, I don't know how to say arcobaleno now, but it's like have any color and you need to respect them.
So you are from Albania, from what town?
I'm born in Elbasan.
Where is that?
It's like 40 miles from the capital, Tirana, yeah.
Yes.
And it's a beautiful country, not because it's my country, but it's,
no,
it's
we
a
know
surreal,
that.
It's a
we
real
were,
one.
We were there.
And I'm very happy that in the last 10 years, it's going very well. And I think soon we'll be part of Union European. And so everybody will know a bit more about this little country who has been so unlucky for this country. 500-year Ottoman Empire, then two war, first and second war, and then communism for 45, 50 years. And then at least in the 90s, everybody recognized was Albania. But still in the last 10 years, I'm more proud of what's going on in our country. And I think soon I'll be very proud.
It's about time.
Yeah, you need a bit of time.
Right.
For so many years
behind,
you need to rush a bit.
Since you mentioned the communism, I think when you were study violin, when you were very young, and they think you are a good musician or you can have a good ear, so you should study violin. Is that the situation when you were young?
I hate to say that, but the communism, what they did with the schools and stuff, it was very good. Probably without this system, controlling every talent, every young talent, and preparing them to the right, I will never be a musician. So I would have been perhaps singer later, but I would never have this preparation with the violin and with music school. And the schools were quite important. So yeah, they did a lot of bad thing to my country, but they took the country, and then from the knowledge, they did a good job. So a country completely destroyed from two war in 50 years. We had opera, theater, cinema, and yeah. But any system, any totalitarian system does that. So sure. It's not something, but, and my story is the story of many other opera singers, you know, where they grow up in the communism countries and then they find the democracy later. But still, perhaps without this DNA, I never would have been so avanti and forward to find something that that probably another guy in a normal situation would have not fight to resist in front of everybody.
How long did you continue with the violin?
I still play sometimes. I'm very bad now. So it's like even I have a very good ear. It's like now it's the only instrument I actually play better piano than violin. But it's the only instrument that if you don't practice, you lost.
Mm. How old were you when you started?
Six.
6 years old.
Yeah.
But you wanted to play piano and not
more,
violin.
Yeah, not yes. violin. They insisted because I had the absolutor. That's what
they thought it.
Yeah, it's better. Mm-hmm. Because you know, for piano you can play the
you push down the key and you get the note.
It doesn't move from there. But for cello and violin, you need a good intonation. So like.
So your parents started.
No, actually, they never said something. At this time, they were teachers from those musical schools, going to the preschool and select kids with talents. So. And they send a paper to my family. It's like, your son will be in the music school. And that's it. You need to. And we are twins. My twin brother was so so angry about that.
Oh, because, really?
Yeah, you said two kids, one with talent and the other one no. I was like, why? What's wrong with me? But yeah, he couldn't. We tried. And then they say, no. He, normal school. This one, to the.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So what does he do? What kind of?
No, he has his family now. It's like he's normal job. It's like everybody's like nobody has music talents in my family. It's like they love it, but, and I think my father passed away 5 years ago. But they have been so happy with me around the world. I bring them everywhere. So
well, he did get a chance to see.
So course, he saw me at Met and Salzburg and Vienna, Berlin, Paris. So everywhere. So. They were quite proud, and still they are. It's like,
do they
enjoy
opera?
They enjoy and they love her son and their
son to
be there and sing and see that they have his son has the attention of the people, but it's not the form of art they discovered with me. To be honest, yeah.
What was the opera they saw the first opera?
First time they saw Così fan tutte, I think.
Oh, really? Where?
In Salzburg.
In Salzburg.
And then.
What did they say to you afterwards?
Nothing was difficult, especially for my father, because he doesn't like operas with recitativi. It was too long for him. He's like, okay, when you do Così fan tutte, don't call me again. But he was being present in all Idomeneo that I did in Zurich, and he's like, Papa, but it's Mozart, it's recitativi as well in this opera. No, but. It's different. You are a king here. That's what and he was staying. He loved it.
Oh, really?
But more they're like normal people who doesn't have that knowledge with opera. They're not connected with Rigoletto, Traviata, the biggest repertoire. You can put them in a Wagner opera or in a Così fan tutte for sure. Even the production was amazing, but the jumping from Albania to Salzburg Festival, it was too much for me.
Right. It must be so proud of you.
Yeah, it's one of those things that I'm proud of myself because I get so much from my family, but I give it back. So
how did you decide, or how did it come about that you went from Albania to Bolzano?
I don't know. Because like you, when you're young, you look, at this time was internet not that powerful. It was not like today, you do your research, you find your perfect teacher, your coach. It was like, no, nothing didn't exist. You pick up an address where it's a school of canto in Bolzano, okay. The festival of Bolzano competition pianist Busoni is there. Mm. So a lot of, and you see that a lot of wonderful conductor are present in this little town who's Bolzano. It's like, for what reason? It was Abado with Gustav Mahler Orchestra, and then Gustav Kuhn, Ashkenazi with Union European Orchestra. It's like a lot of, and the Busoni competition with Argarich and big names of course, you connect with them and you think that this conservatory will be good. So you leave Albania, you take all the money that your family had. It's like, take this one and you leave.
All
and
alone.
Try to, oh, everything. They give it to me, whatever they have it.
But you went by yourself?
By myself. And
at age 18. But you were still more violin then, or you had started singing?
To be honest, I did both the competition to go into school for singing and for conductor, because I thought, I'm a violinist, I know about singing, and perhaps that would be a nice way. I mean, you leave Albania with completely your windows of future open, so you don't have that. And I didn't realize that the voice would be that important to continue in the opera direction. So at this time I had just a voice, okay, and then try to sing or to do something. But the teacher Brunetti told me quite quick, and he said, after a year you will sing.
That's a short time.
Short time.
Why did she say that?
It was clear for them to, because I was not singing with the technique, I was singing with my intuit. So like, mm-hmm. I was imitating big singers of you. So when I went Tito Schipa, for example, I was listening only Tito Schipa, Pourquoi me réveiller, for like 6 months. And when I went, everybody was connected to this. It was not my voice, it was me trying to be Tito Schipa.
Right.
It's like, and exactly the same. When you are young, you try to imitate somebody famous, you don't realize. But then, being in front of everybody in Salzburg, Vienna, London, I mean, the first conductor who trusted me was Papano, doing Janis Kiki in Covent Garden. So you deal with those conductors, they teach you, they give you the best experience, so you learn, and of course you learn how to be on stage yourself, because of course you in a room, in a studio, you can be amazing good, but then you go in front of Betty and you do half of what you did in the studio. So it's not, it's when I'm saying it's not a job for anyone, that's the story. It's like
you have to have the skill,
this courage to be in front of one and do the best.
Does that mean nerves don't play a role? You're able to be at your best when you're under pressure?
You never get nervous?
Yeah, I get nervous, but not nervous. Like, I have other colleagues, they say to me, so you never lose your calm. But deep inside, I am nervous.
Mm.
But the joy to be in front of everyone, to show what I can do, it's more powerful than the freak out about what to say. And sometimes if I don't have this joy, I don't sing that well.
We have much more to talk about, but we need to take a break.
Okay.
We are here on Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Today we're having the great pleasure of speaking with Saimir Pirgu.